God. Danny, would you help me? Steve, would you help? I wrote a couple of books. One of them's called Pucker Up, Kiss Your Past Goodbye. I've only got 24 of them. If they're free of charge, I give them to you in Jesus' name. Raise your hand, and when we run out, we run out. So one per family, if you would. That way, you could pass them on to someone else. It's very easy reading. You'll get blessed by God's grace, and we give it to you in Jesus' name, the Lord being our helper. Brother, make sure that you have 1 Samuel 11th chapter. Is that where you are, brother? 1 Samuel 11th chapter. Well, let me make sure that's where. 1 Samuel 11th chapter, verse number 1. It should be reading Nahash. You don't have the right scripture up there, brother. 1 Samuel 11th chapter, verse 1. Yeah, if you have a Bible, turn to 1 Samuel 11th chapter, verse number 1. I didn't talk to the worship leaders, didn't say a word to them, not one word. I marvel at the leadership of the Holy Ghost. Can anybody help me? I'm used to people responding, so I'll get it out of you. I've preached in Methodist churches where if I got a grunt, it was something else. But I marvel at the song that our brother sang, which connects to the message in its entirety. My lovely wife, Virginia, please stand up if you would. This is my sweetheart, and give her a hand. She stayed with me down through these years. Just a little bit of background. I pastored for 45 years. The last church I pastored was for 36 years. I started it in the living room of a home. And after 36 years, we turned it over to a young whippersnapper, and we were running 2,000 on Sunday morning, 900 on Wednesday night in a town of 8,500 people. You can say, wow. All because of Jesus. All because of Jesus. At this time, I'm a full-time evangelist traveling with Right Way Ministry, a nonprofit organization. I also am president of a two-year Bible college in West Virginia, training young preachers. I mentor a lot of young preachers, try to help them, encourage them, pray for them, pray with them. And this is the second time in 2 weeks I've been in Indiana. Last week we were in Cynthiana, Indiana. Anybody know where that is? That's down in the Evansville area. We were down there. We were in a school that was probably built in the 1800s. And this dear pastor had gone in and started remodeling. Michael Douglas is his name. And coming from that building to this lovely building, what a transition. 1 Samuel, 11th chapter. Let's look. Oh, Jesus, help. We're going to have a time. Tell your neighbor we're going to have a time. Now, when I ask you to respond, I want you to respond. If you don't, I'll come over the seats and I'll get on to you. Because I have a lot of coach in me, by God's grace. I'm not one of these little pansy preachers that couldn't blow the fuzz off a peach. Can I say amen to anybody here? Let's look at verse number 1. Then Nahash. Nahash. Are we here? Nahash. Words are very, very interesting. Nahash, he's the commanding chief of the Amorites. Commanding chief of the Amorites. And the word Nahash in the Hebrew, you might want to write this down, means snake or serpent. Anybody home? Do I have to give you a lecture on who a snake or a serpent would relate to? I do not like snakes. In West Virginia, there are snake handling churches. I was accused in West Virginia as being a snake handler. You got to be kidding me. One time I walked out into the lobby of the church and there was a humongous green snake about that big, huge fangs. You ever seen a green snake? And I walked out there with one of my men. He was a boxer. And I told him, I said, pick that thing up and throw it out of here. Here he is, big old muscle boxer. He looks at me and says, you pick it up and throw it out. I turned back to him and I said, well, you're my armor bearer. You pick it up. He said, well, you're the man of faith and power. You pick it up. Finally, he got a tissue paper and picked that vicious green snake up and threw it outside. I am not a snake handler. Snakes remind us of who? Satan. Get hold of it. Nahash, his name means serpent or snake. Let's read on. Then Nahash, the Amorite, came up and encamped against Jabesh-Gilead, one of the cities of Israel. One of this. Now, if you read the 10th chapter of 1 Samuel, you'll find out that Saul was appointed king by the witness of the Holy Ghost to Samuel the prophet, and they celebrated Saul's kingship. Watch out now. But there was one tribe, the very last verse of chapter 10 of Samuel, there was one tribe that did not honor Saul, did not respect Saul, and did not bring him a gift at his inauguration. Anybody home? Does anybody want to guess what tribe that was? Jabesh-Gilead. And now Jabesh-Gilead they're encircled by Nahash and the Amorites, completely besieged. No one can get in, no one can get out. Amorites, interesting. Where'd they come from? Amorites came from Lot. Anybody ever heard of Lot? When he had an incestual relationship with his daughter. The Amorites did not take care and help Israel when she came out of Egypt. They've always been a bitter enemy of Israel. Now they have besieged a little town called Jabesh-Gilead. Oh, we're going to have a time. At least I am. I don't know about you. And Nahash, verse 1, said to the Jabesh group, make a covenant with us. Wow. Wait a minute. They're besieged. There hasn't been not one fire shot, not one spear thrown, not one arrow fired, and Jabesh is ready to make a covenant with Nahash. Hello? Let me tell you again. There hasn't been one fire shot. There hasn't been one spear thrown, not one arrow launched. And Jabesh-Gilead are already ready to give up and have a peace negotiation, hold on now, with the serpent. Is anybody in the house? May I tell you what God's people are doing in 2015? They're negotiating with the devil. When you got churches that are marrying homosexuals, I'm going to preach, I'm an evangelist, I'll be gone in a couple of days. When you got churches marrying and having homosexuals in the pulpit, God have mercy on us. What is that but negotiating with the devil? Make a covenant with us. You know what that means? That means being married. Being married to the serpent. Whew. We're in an age when evil is called good and good is called evil. Isn't it amazing that when churches take a stand called bashing people, but yet when the world bangs on the church, Nahash says, okay, we'll negotiate with you. I want you to look at the next verse and see what the negotiation means. These are the terms of the covenant. Nahash, the Amorite, answered to Jabesh's group. The elders were there, the deacons. On this condition, I will make a covenant with you. Watch out now. That I may put out all your right eyes and bring a reproach on Israel. I read that and I think, now what's this thing about putting out right eyes and what is this stuff? What's going on? Let me tell you what it is. In those days, warriors always carried their shield in their left hand. They carried their weapon in their right hand. And normally it was close combat. I'm going somewhere. When they were in close combat, they would put their shield in front of them and they would only look out of one eye. Hello, hello, hello. Would anybody guess what eye that would be? Left hand covering left eye, looking at the right eye. Nahash is not stupid. His negotiation is this. I'll pluck out all your right eyes, and I'll bring a reproach reproach. The word reproach means stripping. I'll strip you of something. Well, what's he going to strip them of? Here's what he's going to do. Number one, when he plucks out the right eye, he takes the fight out of them. Well, you know, we just have to succumb to about everything. You know, we don't want to make anybody mad. And I just, you know, wow. I think we ought to just be quiet and calm down, you know, and stay in our little box called the church. And once we go out there, we don't want to do anything that would cause any problems and difficulties. And let's all suck our thumbs together. I have a great gift. My gift is offending people, so stay with me. I'll get to you in just a moment. I'll get to you in a moment. I'm an evangelist. Hallelujah. Two things that are crucial in this negotiation that this snake has with God's people. That right eye will not only take the fight out of them, they will not be able to fight. Warfare would be over. It also, they'll be stripping. Look at this. They'll take their worship away from them, because you better thank God you're under grace today, because in those days, handicapped people could not worship in the synagogue. So not only could they not fight, not only that, but they couldn't worship. So they have to give up their fight. They'll have to, come on now, somebody. Have you given up your fight? Have you surrendered to the enemy? Hey, we're in a war. But our warfare is not carnal. But it's mighty. We've got weapons. Our weapons are mighty weapons for the pulling down of the strong. We don't fight against flesh and blood. My enemy is not homosexuals. I'm called to preach the truth. God loves everybody. But grace, oh, I'm glad I'm under grace. Some of you may be under the law. I'm not under the law. I'm under grace. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Let's all pray. You're not going to get to heaven because of all the good things you do. You get to heaven because of God's grace and the blood of Jesus. I'm getting older. I know one thing. When I go inside the gates of glory, I'll know I got there by the blood of Jesus and God's grace. Grace is unmerited. Grace is undeserved. Grace is unearned. You can't earn it. You'll never merit it. Some of you are looking at me cross-eyed. I'm going to preach anyhow. Don't let the devil tell Brother Wright I'm older. Well, I'm going to tell you something. Get old is not for pansies. Can I get a witness from somebody? Anybody that started this thing that getting old's golden years, they're dumb as a sled track, because when I get up, I have some aches and pains I never knew I had before. Hallelujah. My back goes out more than I do. Can I get a witness? Preach, brother. No fight in them. And the crazy thing, when I read this is true. This is not fairy tale. When I read this and I see that he wants to bring a reproach on Israel, he wants to expose them by stripping. What does he want to strip? He wants to strip away their convictions. He wants to strip away their character. He wants to strip away their conscience. Well, let's listen to God's people. Let's listen to this crowd from Jabesh Gilead. Let's see what they said. Verse 3, the elders of Jabesh said to Nahash, hold off for 7 days, and we're going to go out and see if we can find help. What enemy in the world is going to give you 7 days to go get reinforcements? How cocky, how arrogant is the serpent? Come on. How arrogant would he be that, oh yeah, go ahead and look for 7 days. See if you can find any help. He's cocky. He's overconfident. You know why? Because he knows that Jabesh Gilead did not honor the new king. Hello? And because they didn't honor the new king, Nahash, this serpent, knows that nobody is going to come to their rescue. So he said, go ahead, man. Go out and search all you want to for 7 days. Anybody glad that you got the Lord on your side? Come on, just wave at me. I know you're alive. Well, they send out messengers. And these messengers, verse 4, they come to Saul's hometown. Chapter 10, Saul's been instituted the king. Guess what he did? He goes home and goes out and starts herding the cattle. He doesn't have an army. He didn't have a throne. He's just been called the king by God. And when the messengers came into Jabesh-Gilead, these messengers from Jabesh-Gilead, to Saul's hometown, they tell the first people they meet, we're in trouble. We're surrounded. And we need help. And look at the response. Look at the response in verse 4. And the people of Saul's hometown, they begin to weep. A voice of weeping. It's a hopeless weeping. They know there's no hope. They know there's no help coming. Saul comes into town, head and shoulders taller than any one in all of Israel. He's got an anointing on him. And when he hears what this serpent is getting ready to do to his people, the Bible says in verse number 6 that the Holy Ghost came on him. Anybody here? And the Holy Ghost did not come on Saul to entertain him. The Holy Ghost came on him to equip him for war. He hadn't fought one battle. He doesn't even have an army. The Holy Spirit came on him, and he's angry. I heard somebody say, you know, Brother Wright, we're not supposed to hate anybody, you know. I said, what are you talking about? I hate the devil. Anybody hate the devil? I hate the devil. I hate every demon in hell. I hate them all. And they're real. I've seen them do damage to people's lives. Saul got a holy anger. He's ready to fight. The holy people today are scared to death of the Holy Spirit. I pastored a denominational church at one time, and people started raising, watch out, both hands. And they started doing this, clapping, which is scriptural. And my board had a meeting, denominational church. And we went into the meeting, and do you know what they were discussing? This is it. I thought it was something serious. They said, we got to do something. I said, oh my goodness, what's going on? We got to stop something. I said, what? What do we got to stop? That hand clapping. He said, if we don't stop that hand clapping, pretty soon, everybody will be doing it. And I've even seen one or two raising both hands. And you know what will happen if they start raising both hands. Now, this is okay. Half mass means somebody died. But the Bible says lifting up holy hands, plural, without doubt and without wrath, and clap your hands, all ye people, and shout. They're trying. This is what I told them. I said, you boys are trying to stop what I'm trying to start. Man, the church is alive. Go to churches and it's like being in a funeral home. They got these big old organs. Got Grandma Moses on the piano and sister on the organ. And you walk in. I think it's a haunted house. What's going on here? We need some life. First time I brought drums into a church, I didn't vote on it. I just brought them in. Did you hear me? I didn't vote on it. I just brought them in. That Sunday morning, I had an office to the side, and I cracked my door, and I looked out. Oh, mercy goodness, they're going. They thought I'd brought the devil into the church. There's no demons in those drums. It's not the instrument, it's who plays the instrument. And it's what they're playing. Holy Spirit is not given to us to make us weird. I pastored 2,000 people, and I'm here to tell you, there were some fruits, flakes, and nuts in the crowd that I pastored. It seemed like that everyone that was a fruit or a flake or a nut came to Maranatha Fellowship. It was amazing. Whoa. I guess the Lord knew I'd handle them somehow, some way. I've been attacked in the pulpit when I was pastoring. I'm an evangelist. Now, did I tell you I'm an evangelist? I was attacked 3 times in the pulpit. I'm a nice guy. Can you tell? Anybody tell I'm a nice guy? 3 times I had people charge me in the pulpit. The last time it took 5 guys to get them out of the building. So I don't know about you, but after being attacked 3 times, I'm just a shade gun shy. Hello? Well, we baptized every Sunday night, the last Sunday night of every month, and we did it for over 14 years without canceling baptismal service. And we always made people go through a training before they were baptized, because if you go in there as a sinner, you'll just come out there as a wet one. Well, that particular Sunday, we always did the baptism at the end of the service on Sunday night, but that time we did it at the beginning. And so I got up preaching, and I'm preaching away, and I'm up on the platform, and I'm just preaching away. And as I'm preaching, back in the back, a young man jumps up. Sanctuary holds 1,500 people. He starts running down the aisle. Did I tell you I'd been attacked 3 times in the pulpit? When I see him running down the aisle, I just started shifting over this way, because I knew Virginia Ruth said about right in there, and I knew she would take a bullet for me. Can I get a witness? I get over here, and I'm praying maybe he'll hit the altar. He doesn't hit the altar. He comes leaping up onto the platform, heading. We had choir risers. He ran up those choir risers, jumped into the baptistry, and baptized. Boom. Hello? I'll say it again. He jumped into the... How many people have seen that happen? I never had. He baptized himself. Boy, the crowd went wild. He had gotten saved. He got there late. Didn't have time to go through the class. He was so stirred as I was preaching. He said, I got to get baptized. He ran up, jumped into the water. Someone came to me. One of the old-time saints came to me, and they said, Brother Wright, do you think that took? I said, what do you mean, took? Well, who baptized him? I said, the Father did, and the Son did, and the Holy Ghost did. The Holy Ghost makes us a witness. Saul's so stirred and he has no army. This is how he motivates an army. He sends out word. He took a yoke of oxen, verse 7. He cut that yoke of oxen up in little pieces. He sent it out all over Israel. And this is what he said. If you don't come and join me to go rescue Jabesh Gilead, I'm going to cut up every ox you got, just like I cut this ox up. That you don't know what he means here. When he's talking about cutting up their ox, he's talking about affecting their wallet, because their ox was their IRA, their ox was their retirement, their ox was their daily income. And he said, if you boys don't join my army, I'm going to cut up all of your ox. I'm going to destroy all of your wealth. You know what? They got motivated. Matter of fact, it says in that scripture that they all came in one accord. The next verse says the number of them was 330,000. He had no army. And with one motivational speech, he's got 330,000 volunteers. Put me in, brother. What does it take to motivate you to do something for God? This is my sermon, the next verse. Verse number 9. Saul sends messengers back to Jabesh Gilead. He says, thus you shall say, verse 9, thus you shall say to the men of Jabesh Gilead tomorrow. Everybody say tomorrow. Tomorrow. No, say tomorrow. Tomorrow. Say tomorrow loud. tomorrow, by the time the sun is hot, that's noon, you shall have what? Help. Did you get the first song that they sang tonight? I don't know about you, but I need some help. Wave at me now. I need some help. Young people, you don't need help because you think everything's coming up roses. Put a few years on you and you'll need help. If you're trusting in the Social Security of this nation, I've got good news on you. Something's going to happen soon. Some trust in chariots, some trust in Obama, but others trust in the name of the Lord thy God. Do I have any witnesses here in this house? Here's the message. Saul tells them, you go tell all the people of Jabesh-Gilead, by noon tomorrow, you're going to have help. And when that word got there, verse 9 said, it filled the whole town with joy. The Message Bible says there was great joy throughout the town when the message arrived. Hello. Here's what we would have been saying at that time. He ain't coming. Or don't you remember what happened when he was inaugurated? None of us showed up. We didn't even give him gifts. He just pulling our string. He just jive talking to us. He ain't coming. Do you see anything? Do you feel anything? Only thing we got's one thing. We got a messenger with a message from the king that tells us to hold on. Help's on the way. Oh, man, you ought to be shouting right now. That'd make a Nazarene speak in tongues. I'm here to tell you, God have mercy on you. He doesn't have anything he can see. This crowd only has the word of a messenger that he said he's speaking for the king, and the message is, help's on the way. All you got to do is hold on. Hold on by what? Faith. You can't see anything. I don't feel nothing. But they believe the message by faith, and joy hit the place. Whew. You ever watch Price is Right with Bob Barker? He was 120 when he retired. Price is Right. These crazy people get in this crowd, and they call their names out. And when they call their names out, they jump up. They all become Pentecostals. When they jump up, they go, ah! And they run down, and they're jumping up in the air, and all they're doing is bidding on a refrigerator. And oh, when they win, they run up there and start hugging old Bob and kissing on Bob. Isn't it amazing that we get excited about new cars, new carpet, new shoes, new dresses? Men and women are different. I didn't have one. I had an amen from a lady. The men going, huh? I'll give you a for instance, Jack. You go to a ball game with four or five couples, and my wife gets up at the ball game and says, I'm going to the bathroom. All of the women get up and go together. Can I get a witness from the ladies? If I get up at a ball game and head toward the bathroom, and all six of my buddies go with me, I'm not going to any more ball games with you dudes. Are you talking to me right now? Do you get my drift? Joy comes from Jesus. The joy of the Lord is my... It's no wonder the church is weak. We're scared to death to even smile. I mean, I look at some people, I don't know if you know or not, but I'm pretty funny. I don't try to be funny, it's just who I am. I'm funny. If you don't think I'm funny, you probably died. I preached at a Baptist church, and when it got done, we had a great time. One of the deacons said, he's just too funny. Well, the problem was, he wasn't used to even smiling. I believe if some people in church smiled, their face would crack open and fall to the floor. You can be happy. I was preaching one time, and one of the brothers over here, I was preaching away. One of the brothers over here on the side, he got to laughing. And as he laughed, His false teeth shot straight out. He grabbed his false teeth in midair and put them back in his mouth. I'm preaching and I see that. Do you think I'm going to keep a straight face when he grabs his false teeth in midair? I about lost it. Some people thought the Holy Ghost was on me. No, it was, he was on me. Joy hit the camp. I said, joy hit the camp. And the only thing they had was a message from a messenger to hold on. Help's on the way. Well, I've stopped by tonight to tell you I'm a messenger. And I've got a message from the King of all kings. Here's the message. Hold on. Help is on the way. Say amen. Don't give up. Don't throw in the towel. Hold on by faith to the message. Our God is a good God. My God is not Allah. He murders, he beheads, he kills, he mutilates. My God's a good God. I'm going to go a step further. My God loves me. If he had a refrigerator, my picture would be on it. Anybody else? People ever ask you in Indiana, how you doing? Oh, yeah, how you doing? How you doing? You go to the capture, how you doing? Yeah, here's what we mostly say in West Virginia. Fine. I died last week. Fine. Do you know what I tell them when they ask me? Just the other day, cashier at Target, we were checking out, and she said, "How are you doing?" And this is what I said. I said, "I'm blessed and highly favored." Her eyes got that big. Everybody say these words. I'm blessed and highly favored. Come on, say it out loud. I'm blessed. And highly favored. Well, Brother Roy, you don't know my problems and my difficulty. Well, you're surrounded by Nahash, but I'm here to tell you, help's on the way. Hold on. I haven't come here to beat you up. I haven't come here to put you down. I've come here to tell you that something great's about to happen. My mentors, for years and years and years, preached and told me that something great was about to happen, and they're all gone. Well, I've taken their place. And I'm here to tell you something good's about to happen. Something miraculous is about to spring forth. I wish I had somebody that believed that here today. Something supernatural is on its way to this earth. With our God, anything's possible. Let me give you two scriptures. Matthew 19:26, with God all things are possible. Luke 1:37, with God nothing shall be impossible. Let me give you some review. If an axe head can float, if a donkey can talk, if the Red Sea can split, if the sun can stand still, if water can flow from a rock and feed over 2 million people, if food can fall from the sky, if deaf ears can hear, if blind eyes can see, then I'm here to tell you that my God can do anything. Say amen. Amen. My last year of pastoring, one Sunday night, 5 drug addicts got saved at the altar. Someone passed me a note and said, "Don't you think we should start a meeting?" I got up and said, "How many of you will come?" They all shouted, "We'll come." I said, we'll keep having meetings till no one gets saved." It lasted for 11 weeks. You didn't hear me. 11 weeks. People got saved every night for 11 weeks. 836, whatever. I never had ever seen a blind eye open. Pastored 45 years, never. I read about it, never seen it. I'm preaching, invitation, lady comes to the altar, she's crying. She's boo-hooing. I think she's going to get saved. So I go down and say, can I help you? She said, I can see. I said, well, that's great. No, she said, I was blind. I said, what? She said, I was blind. A little old lady, not even ordained. Did you hear me? A little lady came over and laid hands on this blind girl, and this blind girl's eyes opened up. Hello? A deaf man's up in the balcony. A lady just reaches over and gives him a hug. And when she gave him a hug, pow, his ears opened up. Do you think he's rejoicing? Oh, Mom. He's up there praising God. All the lady did was put her hands around him. The Bible says you shall lay hands on the sick. We think it has to be here. It can be here. It can be here. And when she laid hands on him with a hug, pow, he could hear. Does anybody think he can do it today? I would not go to church. I would not support a church that did not believe in miracles. Because from the cradle to the grave, you're going to need a miracle. At the Maranatha Fellowship, there would be people come from other churches. Churches that didn't believe in miracles. And they would come to Maranatha because they knew we believed in miracles and they needed one. Does anybody here need a miracle tonight? Come on now, talk to me. Well, I believe you need to get ready because God's going to loose a suddenly season on the church. A suddenly season. The book of Acts, I love the book of Acts. The book of Acts is full of suddenlies. Second chapter, book of Acts, verse number 2. 120 of them are praying in the upper room. They don't know what's going to happen. They didn't have a checklist. Jesus just said, go there and wait on it. And so they're up in that upper room, been there for 10 days praying. In verse 2, chapter 2 of the book of Acts, and it says suddenly, say suddenly. It says suddenly there came a sound, as a mighty rushing wind, and it filled the whole house. That sound of a mighty rushing wind was like a hurricane. They say when a hurricane comes through a house, it sounds like a freight train coming through. What's going to happen when suddenly God fills the whole house? You know, revival always starts with a sound. It hadn't rained for 3.5 years. And all of a sudden, Elijah is up on Mount Carmel. This is what he says. There's not a cloud in the sky. Elijah, 3.5 years it hadn't rained. This is what he says. Hey, I hear the sound of abundance of rain. No one else heard it. His servant didn't hear it. Nobody heard it but Elijah. But Elijah heard a sound before one drop of rain ever came. You can call me foolish, stupid, whatever you want to. It don't matter. I know who I am. And I believe suddenly seasons are going to hit. And I'm going to be in it. See, suddenly seasons when you don't expect it. You're just pulling up in front of the church and just going in, or you're going to your prayer closet, you know, and you just say, same old, well, pow! Saul is on his way to Damascus with orders from the high priest. Boy, religion gets vicious. Judaism got so caught up in laws and regulations that the high priest was killing Christians. And Saul had orders from the high priest to go to Damascus and arrest and bind every Christian and drag them back to Jerusalem. They had already stoned Stephen. It's vicious when the church turns on each other. Religion will do it every time. So old Saul's going down the highway toward Damascus. And the ninth chapter of the book of Acts. And it says this. Suddenly, a light shone from heaven and knocked Saul to the ground. People all the time. See, you're scared of the Holy Ghost. People all the time say, Brother Wright, Have you seen these people just fall on the carpet? Yeah. What do you think about that? What's what happened to Saul? Saul just going down the road, pow! He hits the deck. So I don't believe in that. Get out of line. It don't bother me none. I was in a meeting in Florida. I took a busload down to a meeting that was a revival meeting. It had lasted for about 6 years. I took a busload, a big old Greyhound busload and a van load, and we got to the motel this morning. One of my men went over to find the church, and he calls me up. It's 10 o'clock in the morning. He says, "Brother Wright?" I said, "Yeah, brother." He said, "You ain't gonna believe this." I said, "What?" He said, "There's people in line." I said, "In line what, McDonald's?" He said, "No, they're already, it's 10 o'clock in the morning. Service starts at 7 p.m. He said, "There's folk in line." I said, "You mean they're in line?" He said, "Brother, I got here, I think he got there at 8, and he said, "I'm not in the front." I loaded everybody up. I said, "Gang, we're loading up." They said, "Where are we going?" I said, "We're going to church." They said, "My goodness, it doesn't start till 7. I said, "Just get on the bus." When we got there and we got in line, we were 100 yards from the front door. They were 4 abreast. People in front of us were from Japan, Germany. Brother, when the doors opened, there were some entrepreneurs there, because the man across the street went out and bought a bunch of plastic chairs and he was selling them for a dollar. When you stand up from 8 a.m. till 7 p.m., brother, you buy a chair. The pizza man was going up and down the aisles. Anybody want pizza? When those doors opened up at 6 o'clock, people stampeded in that church. I've never seen people run into the church. They had chairs in front of the pews all the way to the altar. My wife and I got up close. Great preaching. When a preacher gave an invitation, the ushers came and said, "Fold up all these chairs." There were about 5 rows of folding chairs all the way across. I said, "Do what?" He said, "Fold them up. Put them all against the wall." Clanging, banging, clanging, banging. I said, "Ain't nobody going to get saved. All this noise, clanging, banging. We're used to bow your head and close your eyes, banging and clanging." And then he said, "You people get along the walls." We're right along the walls. And the pianist hit the keyboard. The invitation was given. They began to run from the balconies. They were down the aisles getting saved. Does anyone think I was stirred? After 45 minutes of counseling the people around the altars, they gave them information, sent them back to the seat. Then he said, "If anybody wants prayer, any Christians here just want prayer, come on up." I came off the wall. I got in line. The place was packed. People wanting prayer. This big 6'3" or 6'4" Jewish Messiah. He was a Messianic Jew, saved Jew. Dr. Brown's his name. He came through the crowd. It was like the splitting of the Red Sea. And I turned, and Dr. Brown's right here on me. He's 6'3" or 6'4". He's right here on me. And Dr. Brown, this is the prayer he prayed for me. He didn't know me from anybody. This is what he prayed. He laid his hand on my chest and said, "Fire!" I jumped too. The next thing when I came to, I crawled to the front pew and I said, "Who hit me? What went on?" There was an anointing on me. When I got back to my congregation, I'm here to tell you, God broke loose like I'd never seen in all of my life. Don't put the Holy Spirit in a box, and don't be afraid of the move of God, because it will happen suddenly. I believe your suddenly is coming. Let me tell you about Jesus. You got a minute? Let me tell you about Jesus. Let me describe Jesus to you, okay, so you get a good comprehension of Jesus. Jesus is a mountain mover. Here's what we do. We go up to God and we talk about God. We describe our mountain. "Oh God, my mountain's so big, I can't." But that's not what Jesus said to do. Jesus said to go up to your mountain and tell your mountain how big your God is, and tell your mountain to move. Quit talking about how big your mountain is and start talking about how big your God is. Jesus is a mountain mover. He's a wonder worker. My Jesus is a problem solver. Hallelujah. He's a burden bearer. My Jesus is a storm stopper. He's a promise keeper. He's a way maker. Glory to God. I'm going to preach myself happy. He's a body healer. He's a soul saver. And Jesus is just the same today. It's not good English, but I believe God ain't done with you yet. I don't care how old you are. God ain't done with you yet. If you're still walking, talking, and breathing, God ain't done with you yet. Listen to me. I believe Jesus can turn your test into a testimony. Everybody goes through tests. I believe Jesus can turn your mess. Boy, do we make messes out of our... Has anybody ever been in a mess besides me? The Lord can turn your mess into a miracle. Yesterday, I'm on Facebook. I'm a Facebook detective. Anybody on Facebook? I love Facebook. I tell people where I'm going to preach, and I just love Facebook. I love them. Well, Facebook yesterday, I've got, 1,500 people following me on Facebook. And on Facebook, I put if anybody needs prayer, private message me, and I'll pray for you. Brother, every bing, my phone, bing, my phone, bing. I prayed for every one of them individually. One lady texted me, and she said, Brother Wright, pray for me. She said her female organs were out of line. She was going to a female doctor, and he was going to line up surgery for her. She's on the way to the doctor. I prayed for her. I prayed, Lord Jesus, put everything back in order. She got to the doctor. She went into the doctor. He examined her. He said, everything is back where it's supposed to be. She got on Facebook and began to testify. One man was having heart palpitations. He thought he was having a heart attack. Boom, text me. I prayed at that moment, and his heart palpitations stopped instantly. Michelle Carpenter, down in South Carolina, text me. She had banged her knee up. She's an athlete. She had banged her knee up. She's going to face surgery. We prayed a little simple prayer. Lord, touch that knee. She texted me later in the evening. She said, my knee has been healed. I wish I had some help in the house. God can take any mess through Jesus and turn it into a miracle. I'm getting ready to give you a big one. Jesus can turn your battles into blessings. Say amen. Amen. Don't let the devil shock you, and don't let the devil stop you, and don't let the devil shut you up. It's time for the redeemed of the Lord to say so. If the devil can shut you up, he'll shut you down. The churches of yesterday, you could hear him before you got in the building. But we've been shut down by being shut up. Silence feeds your fears. Get the word. Get you some promises. I have a whole list of promises that I read. I was reading them today. I read them out loud because faith comes by hearing. That just doesn't mean when he's up here preaching. That means every day you read God's word, faith will get in your spirit. Logic comes from your mind, but faith comes from your spirit, who you really are. Feed your spirit. I believe God's going to take somebody in this house who has a bunch of problems that cannot be solved. And he's going to take your problem. Jesus Christ is going to take your problems and turn them into promotion for you. You need to find out who you are in the kingdom. Amen. Here's what we say. Listen to me. Listen to me. Listen to me. I'm nobody. And I'm nothing. And yeah, that's true. When I was lost. But my God thought I was so valuable that he sent Jesus die on an old rugged cross. Does anybody here realize that we're to preach the gospel? Gospel? Does anybody know what the word gospel means? Good news. I know some of you have turned me off. That's your privilege. There is no bad news in good news. I'll talk over here. There is no bad news. If I'm giving you good news, then I can't mix bad news with the good. But what about people going to hell? But I'm not.
Amen.
Hello? You know why I'm not? It's not because of what I've done. It's because of what He did. We all talk about what we've done. I haven't done anything. He did it all. He said, it's finished. Glory to God. And when He said, it's finished, I got in it by faith. The gospel is the death and the burial and the resurrection of Jesus. You can't get saved unless you believe that He died for you. Glory to God. He took your place on the cross. He shed His blood, and without the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sin. And He was buried. And the third day, He's alive. And because He's alive. I said, because He's alive. Here's the key, and I'm going to close. Don't get excited when a preacher said he's going to close. Here's the key. Number one, turn everything over to Jesus. Here's what we do. We go to the altar. We give it to Him. We get up. We pick it up and take it back. Cast all your cares upon Him, because He cares about you. He cares about you. He cares about you. A man tells his wife he cares about her and beats her up. He don't care about her. Jesus cares about you. He didn't beat you up. He hadn't come to beat you up. He's come to build you up in the faith. We walk by faith. Give everything to Jesus. Turn it over to Him. Lock, stock, and barrel. But Brother Wright, what are we going to do? We're going to trust God. I know people right now, they're storing up food because, you know, it could get rough. And there's a guy in West Virginia, he's got about 100,000 rounds of ammunition. He's going to fight a war. He got 100,000 rounds of ammunition. I'm thinking, where's that in the gospel? Hello, talk to me. Where's that in the gospel? He didn't say, okay, guys, load up, bring your submachine guns and load up. Now, I believe in protecting yourself. I'm not stupid. We live in a wicked world. But, brother, we're supposed to spread the good news. If you're lost, there's hope for you. If you're sick, there's hope for you. Your miracle is just on the other side of your obedience. If He tells you to go wash in the pool of Siloam, go wash. Whatever He tells you to do, do it. Give it all. Number two, hold on to God's promises and not your problems. Quit talking about your problems and start talking about the promises. We've got to change our thinking. One of the definitions for repenting is change your thinking. Change the way you think. And we just talk and talk about our problems. Have you ever met people and you say how they're doing and they start talking about their problem? And listen to me. And then the person who asked how they're doing says, you think you got problems? Listen to mine. And then when they give their, they'll say, you think you got problems? I can top that one. Well, I can beat that. What in the world? We got a contest going on. Who's got the biggest problems? Why don't we get together and have Holy Ghost fellowship? And you throw me a scripture and I throw one back to you. Old Brother Mitchell was his name. Old Brother Mitchell. He came into a meeting. Old West Virginia hillbilly country preacher. He came in the meeting. He got there. The crowd was all there. Preacher's up there. He got in the back and quoted a scripture out loud. The preacher in the pulpit quoted a scripture out loud. Then he quoted one. Down the aisle, back and forth, quoting scriptures. As a young preacher, I was about to come out of my seat. Don't talk about your problem. Talk about the promises of God. Number three. Don't let Satan put fear on you. Fear is a spirit. God's not given us the spirit. I'm going to tell you, panic attacks are as real as anything there is. And they're from the devil. You've got to rebuke him. Plead the blood. Don't let the devil put fear on you. God puts peace on you, love on you, joy on you. One last thing. Turn to Acts, the 16th chapter. Paul's delivered a young fortune teller, demons within her. She gets saved. The people that owned her, her pimps, of course, you people are holding this people. You don't know what a pimp is. Adjust your halos. And these pimps were so mad that they lost their income from this girl, demon-possessed, fortune teller, that they got a hold of Paul and Silas, dragged them to the magistrates, and they beat them. They beat them with whips. Now, they drag them to the jail in Philippi. They drag them to the jail. Their backs are bleeding. They tell the jailer, you don't lose these boys. You lose them. You lose your life. He takes them down to the bottom part of the dungeon, and he handcuffs them. He shackles them. Listen to me. It's midnight. Those boys' backs are bleeding. The only reason they're there is Paul had a vision, and he saw someone in Kokomo saying, come over here and help us. And so Paul, it was at Macedonia, really. So Paul tells Silas, we're going to Macedonia. Silas didn't have any leading. Paul had it. But now, because of that vision, Silas got his back bleeding, his hands are cuffed, and his feet are shackled. If that being the average, ordinary two preachers in a jail, old Silas would have said to Paul, you and your visions, look where you got us today. Hello? They're not sighing. They're not pouting. They're not feeling sorry for themselves. Midnight, Acts 16 chapter, verse 25. And midnight is not the end of the day. It's the beginning of a new. It's the dawning of a new day. And at midnight, they are singing and praising God. And suddenly, I believe God just grabbed that one building and he shook it. I don't believe anywhere else in that town anything moved but that jail. And it says everyone's chains were loosed. Everyone's prison doors were open. I'll say it one more time. Everyone's chains were loosed and everyone's doors were open. I'm from West Virginia. If I've been put in prison on false accusations, and I've been whipped, I'm chained, and an earthquake hits, and my chains fall off, and my feet are unshackled, and the prison door opens up, I don't need three witnesses and four people to tell me what to do. My daddy didn't raise no fool. I'm down the road. I'm a shouting and praising God, saying, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, I'm out of here. Glory to God. Of course, I read the next day in the paper that a jailer had killed himself. Paul and Silas didn't go anywhere because their suddenly season was going to affect somebody else. Jailer woke up, got ready to kill himself. Paul said, don't harm yourself. We're all here, all here, all here. No prisoners left. The anointing was so strong that not one prisoner left. And the jailer came in and fell down at the feet of Paul and said, what must I do to be saved? And Paul said, join our church. Sign our card. Go through a 6-week catechism class. No, get sprinkled or dunked or dipped. No. He said, you must believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you shall be saved. But, oh, I've got a deal for you today. Verse 31. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you shall be saved. And everybody in your house. Devil tells you your kids aren't coming in. I tell him he's a liar. Our son Jamie pastors a brand new church. Started a year ago. He's running about 150 already. Our baby girl is her and her husband pastor in Hickory. She's a worship leader. Her husband preaches. Our middle son, quiet. For years and years and years, running. I was in Lake Charles, Louisiana, getting ready to preach a revival. Phone rang in the hotel. I picked it up. It was our son, Jason. He said these words. He said, "Dad," he said, "I've run for 28 years. I'm coming home." I can't tell you how many times Satan told me he'd never get in. But I told Satan more than once, "You're a liar. You'll not have one of my children." I threw the phone to my wife. I fell down on my knees in that motel room, and I began to praise God. Because by God's grace, all of our children are saved, washed in the blood of the Lamb. And now God's given us 12 grandchildren to pray for. Stand to your feet. I hope I haven't bored you. Let's pray. Oh, bless you, Jesus. Just praise Him wherever you are. Would you just praise Him right now? Come on, just praise Him. Surely you got something to thank the Lord about. Surely you got something to thank the Lord about. Hallelujah. Glory to the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Bless you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Help's on the way. Help's on the way. Help's on the way. Help's on the way. Hold on. Hold on. Hold on. Hold on. Don't be weary in well-doing, but in due season you shall reap. If you faint not, don't give up. Don't give up. Hold on by faith. Hold on by faith. Help's on the way. Help's on the way. Help's coming. Help's coming to your house. Hallelujah. If there's anybody here that you have a son or a daughter who's out of the ark of safety, I want you to come to this altar. And I want you to tell the enemy in the name of Jesus, "You'll not," and I want you to name him. "You'll not have my son," name him. "You'll not have my daughter," name him. You can stand, you can kneel, it doesn't matter. Come right now. If you've got a son or a daughter out of the ark of safety, come, come, come. I believe help's on the way for you. Call their name out right now. You don't have to scream it. Just call their name out right now. Devil's not going to have them. If you're in this house and you need help, physical help, spiritual help, financial help, if you're in the house and you need help, come to the altar right now. Come to the altar right now. Anybody here need help in any area of your life? Come on. Just going to have a word of prayer. If you need help, hit the altar right now. If you need help, hit the altar right now. Don't be afraid. God's in the helping business. As you come, tell the Lord what you need. Come on, open your mouth up. Don't meditate a prayer. Open your mouth up. Tell the Lord what you need. Tell the Lord what you need right now. Just going to be here for a moment. You've got to believe. You've got to believe. You've got to receive. Get your hands in a position to receive something. Get your hands out in front to receive something. Now begin to pray. Tell the Lord where you need help. Tell the Lord where you need help. If it's in your kidneys, say, "Lord, I need help in my kidneys." If it's because of finances, "Lord, I need help." Whatever it is, be specific. Pinpoint your prayer. Pinpoint your prayer. Pinpoint your prayer. Bless you, Jesus. Father, I pray now in the name of Jesus. You hear every prayer. You've heard the names of sons and daughters being called out. You've heard the needs, the requests being made known to you, Father, in the name of Jesus. And Father, tonight we declare by faith that help is on the way. I said by faith, we declare that help's on the way. Now lift your hand just a little higher and say, "Father," come on, say it out loud, "Father, in the name of Jesus, by faith, I believe that help is on the way. Say it again. By faith, I believe that help is on the way. And I'm going to hold on by faith until it arrives. Now clap your hands and give God praise. Bless you, Jesus. Bless you, Jesus. Bless you, Jesus. Hey, what can I say but thank you for coming? I'll come back tomorrow night. I'm going to share about the woman with the issue of blood. Turn and hug two or three necks. Tell them you love them. Thank you for being here.